Church, it's good to see everybody again today, and we are super excited about the new series that we are starting, When the Helper Comes. I hope you guys are ready. Are you guys ready? I hope you're ready because God is always ready. And if you're not ready, you miss out. Always be prepared. We have a saying where we say, preparation plus opportunity equals destiny. I'm going to say it again. Preparation plus opportunity equals destiny. So God is preparing you, and He's building into your life, He's building into your spirit. And when the opportunity comes, you are ready. You're prepared. So don't miss the opportunities that God brings in front of you. That'll take you into your destiny. And when the Helper comes, when the Holy Spirit comes to advance your life, be ready that He's going to take you on an adventure. He's going to take you high places. He's going to take you places this world cannot take you. He's going to show you who you really are. This world cannot show you who you are. Your destiny does not lie within this world, it lies within the Holy Spirit. And so when He comes, not everything will make sense. When He comes, you will have supernatural power. You will have supernatural abilities. Gifts will flow in you and through you. And you will shake this nation when He comes. And you better be ready. How many of you know that being a Christian or being a child of God means that you will not have an average, mediocre life? We were not called for mediocrity. Amen? We were called for greatness. And so it's impossible for the Holy Spirit to dwell in you and live an average life. You will have many persecutions. You will have many trials and tribulations. It's normal. The world will hate you. It's supposed to be like that. Jesus said that. It's not always easy. It's not always fluent. We have our ups and our downs. But in all of this, Christ is glorified. And so you can follow the sermon, the notes with me on the YouVersion Bible app. If you open your phone, you can scan that QR code and you can follow the notes with me as I go through the scriptures, etc. This morning. So the reason why we do this series is obviously we're going into the season of Pentecost now, and you know, the Holy Spirit was poured out onto the 120 in the upper room, and it was the moment where two worlds formed one. It was the moment where heaven and earth collided, because heaven and earth was never meant to function as two separate worlds, right? Heaven and earth was always created to function as one world. Heaven on earth, as it is in heaven, so it must be on the earth. And so the spirit realm, the heavenly realm, expresses itself through people into the natural realm. And so these two worlds, heaven and earth, connects through the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. And so this sermon series is supposed to help us to live in power, to walk in communion with the Holy Spirit, so that we can live out our God-given purpose and our God-given calling. So I want you to make notes during the sermon. Take these notes, take it to your city group during the week, your cell group during the week. Make sure that you are connected with us in the series. So the first point of contact is obviously to ask the question, who is the Holy Spirit and what does He do? The Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity, as we all know, and He is exactly 100% fully God, just as Jesus is, just as the Father is. The only difference is He has a different role within the body. The Holy Spirit right now is God on the earth. The Father is in heaven, and right next to him sits Jesus, the Son of God, the ruler of heaven and earth. They are in heaven. But the Holy Spirit is the one who dwells on the earth. And the Holy Spirit makes his dwelling place in our bodies. Our bodies are the new temple, or is the new temple for him. Our bodies makes the Holy Spirit legal on the earth. Because any spirit needs a body in order to function and have legal dominion on the earth. And so that is who he is. And so the Holy Spirit is the very spirit of Jesus, and he is the representative of God the Father and Jesus Christ on the earth. It was the Holy Spirit who prophesied Christ in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit was also responsible for the conception of Jesus within Mary. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit overshadowed Mary and gave birth. Jesus was born out of the Spirit, which was not out of the seed of Adam, but out of the seed of the Holy Spirit, which made him sinless. The Holy Spirit was also the one who came and rested upon Jesus, who anointed Jesus for his earthly ministry when he was baptized. Jesus was fulfilled with the Holy Spirit from conception within Mary's womb. In that time, he was already filled with the Holy Spirit. But in the baptism, then he was anointed by the Holy Spirit and came down like a dove and sat on Jesus. And the Bible says then he remained on Jesus. And then everything Jesus did on the earth was through the Holy Spirit and with the power of the Holy Spirit. He gave up his godly privileges in order for him to model to us how to live our earthly lives. He was dependent on the Holy Spirit to show us how to walk with the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus now is in heaven, and then he obviously sends his Holy Spirit, and he says it is necessary for him to leave and go to heaven in order for him to send his Holy Spirit, because his Holy Spirit will be able to be in a lot of places at one stage. But Jesus was bound by his body, and so he could not be everywhere every time. But the Holy Spirit can live in all of us at once. So it will be beneficial for us to receive the Holy Spirit. But the one who baptizes us with the Holy Spirit is Jesus himself. When you are baptized with the Holy Spirit, Jesus in heaven does it himself. John says this in Matthew 3 verse 11. The New King James Version, he says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Holy Spirit, fire. It's a purifying fire. Amen. It's a fire that consumes you. It's a fire that burns away everything that is not God. So, myths about the Holy Spirit. Firstly, is he's not just a power source. He is a person who has emotions, feelings, a will, intellect. In fact, we look like him, right? He is a person that you can have communion with, that you can have a relationship with. You can't have a relationship with a source of power. You can only have a relationship with another person. So he's not just a power source, he's a person. Secondly, people think that the Holy Spirit moves based on our performances. And so wherever we live right or wherever we do things according to the book, then that inspires the Holy Spirit to move. It does not work like that. The Holy Spirit is not impressed by your performance. He's not drawn to you by your living right. He's drawn to you by your surrender. How many of you know that the Holy Spirit moves by invitation? He does not force himself onto anybody. Never. He does not kick the door open. He knocks on the door and waits for you to say, come in. And so the Holy Spirit waits on us to say, Lord, you're welcome to do as you wish. I surrender my heart to you. Not based on your performance. Because if you try to perform, pride creeps in. Because performance seeks self-glorification. And it doesn't work like that. The third myth about the Holy Spirit is people think sin offends him. We think that when we struggle with things, we fall in weakness or into temptation. The Holy Spirit is offended. No, man. He is the one who took sin out of you through the blood of Christ. He's not offended by your sin. He's there to empower you to overcome sin. So we think when we sin or when we fall, the Holy Spirit takes offense, and then you feel this feeling of shame on you, and you feel like you've lost your calling, and you've lost all power, you've lost your anointing, you've somehow lost your identity as well. No, that's not true. We'll get into that now. So there are a few things the Holy Spirit does. Like I mentioned, the first one of the things he does is he empowers you for your earthly ministry. Matthew 16 verse 19 helps us to understand in the Message translation that there are no boundaries between earth and heaven. I want to read to you the scripture. You will have complete and free access to God's kingdom, not one day, now. Keeps to open any and every door. Now listen, no more boundaries between heaven and earth, earth and heaven. There is no more separation. So Ephesians 1 says that the heavenly blessings that God has for us, we have access now to. We have access to it now. So whatever you need to live out your godly purpose on earth, you have got access to it. God provides these things to you. Then Acts 1 verse 8 says, but you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witness. In other words, when the power of God comes upon you, there will be evidence upon your life that God lives, because power will flow from you. Signs, wonders, and miracles will happen in you and through you. And people's lives will be radically changed because of the power of the Holy Spirit that comes upon you. And people will see that Jesus truly lives. You will be a witness of that. John 14 verse 12. Jesus says, I tell you this timeless truth. How many of you know truth is not subject to time? It's not bound by time. The truth is the truth. The truth is not past tense. The gospel is not past tense. It's present continuous tense. Meaning that is the gospel is not just something that happened in the past. It still happens today. It's still relevant today. When you come to Christ, when you experience the love of Jesus, it feels to you that Jesus was crucified on the cross just now. It feels real to you now. It's a revelation to you now. Although it happened 2,000 years ago, it feels like it happened just now. But he says, I'm telling you this timeless truth. The person who follows me in faith, believing in me, will do the same mighty miracles that I do, even greater. Now, this is a bold thing to say, right? So he empowers us. Mark 16, verse 15. These signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents with their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Nice. And I assume everybody of us wants to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. But I want to tell you that for you to walk in power is not the first desire of the Holy Spirit. He has a greater desire. And that desire is to have intimacy with you. He wants you to know Him personally. It is the Holy Spirit's desire to dwell in you, to live amongst His people. Intimacy. And as you get to know Christ, as you get to know the Holy Spirit and pick up His heart, to know what He's like, and know, you know, how He moves and how He functions, power will flow automatically. We try to force the power of the Holy Spirit upon things. We try to pray for people, and we try to, you know, pray weird stuff and use wise words and whatever. But before we do that, He first wants us to know Him. Because a Christian's reward, like we always say, is not heaven one day, but it is restored intimacy with God right now. That is our reward. And so 2 Corinthians 6, Paul says in verse 16, says, I will make my dwelling among them and I will walk among them. And Hebrews 8 says the very same thing. Verse 10. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts, and I will be their God and they shall be my people. And so now, as we have relationship with the Holy Spirit, as we get to know Him personally, He teaches us all things. He teaches us about Christ. He then teaches us about ourselves. He shows us who we are. And then He teaches us how to live life. And Jesus says, John 14, 26. You can put that on the screen. There we go. But when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, as I mentioned earlier, that is the Holy Spirit, He will teach you everything and will remind you of everything that I have told you. He will teach you all things. He will even teach you how to run your business. How many of you know He is a mastermind entrepreneur? He knows how to build a business. He will teach you all things. He teaches you about Christ. John 15, 26. But I will send you the Advocate, the Spirit of Truth, and He will come to you from the Father and will testify about Me. You cannot know Christ without knowing the Holy Spirit. He reveals the love of Christ to you. The Holy Spirit is the one who brings the message of Christ to you. He is the one that exposes the good news to you. So if you don't know the Holy Spirit, you won't know the message of Christ. If you deny the Holy Spirit, you deny the message of Christ. He is the one that contains the forgiveness that Christ has to offer you. And when you say yes to the Holy Spirit, you say yes to forgiveness. He is the one who manifests forgiveness into your heart. So He teaches you about Christ. And then when He does that, you get to know Christ more. And watch now what happens. As you get to know Christ more, you get to know yourself more. As your knowledge of Jesus improves, your knowledge about yourself also improves, because your identity is in Christ. And the more you see Christ, you see yourself. So when you meet Jesus, you meet yourself. So the Holy Spirit then secondly presents you to yourself and says, this is who you are. Now, listen to Colossians 3. This is a powerful scripture. Your old life is dead. Your new life, which is your real life, even though invisible to spectators, is with Christ in God. He is your life. So, if you don't know the Holy Spirit, you will never know yourself. Because your identity is revealed through Him. You will not find yourself in your work. You will not find yourself in money. You will not find yourself in a country, in a government, in your wife, in your husband, in your friends, in whatever. You will get tired searching for yourself in these things. That is why the Holy Spirit desires intimacy. So that you can know yourself. Now Jesus says in John 16, I'm giving you scripture because we need scripture to fall back onto. The work of the Holy Spirit in verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go that I just mentioned. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send Him to you. And when He comes, He will convict the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment, or truth. So what the Holy Spirit does now is as He teaches us about ourselves, He upholds not the record of our wrongdoing, but He upholds our identity. Because Jesus says, when I send the Helper, the law will not be written on stone, but the law will now be written within their hearts. Meaning that the law is not something I have to do, but the law is now something I am. Let me explain. The law says, you shall not steal, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not do this, you shall not do that. That was something you had to do in the Old Testament. But now, when the law is in your heart, it's not that I don't steal because it's wrong. It's I don't steal because it's not who I am. It's that I don't do sin because it's wrong. I don't sin because it's not who I am. You get what I'm saying? Why do I not watch pornography? Not because it's wrong, it's because I'm better than that. Why don't I steal? Not because I'm scared of jail, it's because it's not aligning with my new God-given nature. So if I fall into sinful things, only what the Holy Spirit does is He will now convict me by showing and upholding my identity. This is who you are, now live accordingly. I remember when I was 17 years old, I had a French girlfriend. Isaline Thion, dangerous. Je parle le français. Oui, oui. And she was attracted to me because my name is Pierre. You know, it's a French. Oui. And she says, I look as a French. With my eyes and look French. And so when she heard my name, she stopped and she pulled me, and she was a beautiful girl. I was a virgin at that time. She wasn't, because she's European. European ladies, they are dangerous. You must get yourself a South African. To all the Americans, get a South African lady or husband. Okay, they're solid. So she found out I was still a virgin. And she said, well, she'll help me. I said, because I felt stupid being a virgin because they made me feel stupid. I was the only one still a virgin in the group of a bunch of teenagers. And so one night I visited her at her home, and her parents were there, and we watched a movie, and they went to bed, and she said, would you like some popcorn for the movie? And I said, well, we can have some popcorn. And she stood up, she went to the kitchen, 2 minutes went by, 5 minutes went by, 10 minutes went by. I was like, how long does it take to make popcorn? Does the French ladies not know how to make popcorn? You put it into the microwave, pa. I looked just around the corner, I saw her standing in the kitchen, and she did this to me. I was like, do you need to help me? You need help with the popcorn? And so I stood up, went to her, and she led me past the kitchen into one of the spare bedrooms. She lied on the bed. She took off all her clothes. I'm a 17-year-old boy. Can't watch, my mom will, you know, give me a hiding. This happened 2 months after I gave my life to Christ, was baptized in water and with the Holy Spirit, could pray in tongues. Now I was standing there, this girl exposing herself to me. You know what the Holy Spirit did? Didn't condemn me. Peter, why? How could you do this? How could you be in this situation? The only thing he did was he whispered into my spirit, Pierre, remember who you are. That didn't give me a feeling of condemnation, but that gave me a sense of pride. I'm a son of God. Now live accordingly. And so the Holy Spirit empowered me just by upholding my identity. And that was enough for me to say no to the lady. And I thank God because I kept my virginity for my wife. And I could give her the gift of the treasure that is within me, and I could share it with her. So that's what he does. You know, he reminds, you know, sin talks of your identity. You're not a sinner anymore, you're a child of God. Then he convicts you of your righteousness. That speaks of your position in Christ. You are in right standing with him. Know where you are functioning from. Don't be desperate. Don't lose yourself trying to impress worldly people. Know where you are functioning from. You are seated with Christ in heaven. Now live accordingly. Amen. A dangerous thing that we as children of God do is we get familiar with God. We call it familiarity with God. You know, when we lose our respect and our honor for the presence of God. It's like when you married your wife, you know, in the beginning of your marriage, it was this, wow, woohoo, yay, you really appreciate her. And then you start to become familiar with your wife and you get used to her. You don't give her the respect and the love and the things you gave her when you were married in the first year or two. If we lose our reverence for God, if we lose our respect for God, you will start to operate out of your own power. You must be aware of becoming familiar with God. It happened to Jesus in his hometown. You know, Jesus couldn't do one miracle in his hometown, because they were familiar with him. Let me read to you, Mark 6. Jesus left that part of the country. You guys can put it on the screen, thanks. Jesus left that part of the country and returned with his disciples to Nazareth, his hometown. Verse 2. The next Sabbath he began teaching in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed, and they asked, "Where did you get all this wisdom and power to perform such miracles?" Then they scoffed, "He's just a carpenter. The son of Mary and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. And his sisters live right here among us." And they were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. Then Jesus told them, "A prophet is honored everywhere except in his hometown. And among his relatives and his own family. And because of their unbelief, he couldn't do any miracles among them." How many of you know that the Holy Spirit is omnipresent, meaning he is everywhere, but he is not welcomed everywhere? To welcome is an official acknowledgement. To say, "I welcome you," means that I officially acknowledge your presence. You can sit around a meeting table and not feel welcome. You're there, but you don't feel welcome. They don't ask for your input. They don't give you attention. They don't give you time to speak. And you feel like you are just there. And if you're not welcomed, what will you do? You will then obviously withdraw from the conversation, right? Because I'm not welcome. You get what I'm saying? But when somebody says, "Hi, Pierre, welcome to the meeting. Here's a chair. Can I offer you coffee? Listen, we are so excited that you are here. We are in need of your wisdom, etc." And when we have the business meeting, we draw from you. And it's the same with the Holy Spirit. We need to honor his presence more. We should not take his presence lightly. Because if we don't honor his presence, that means that I have the subconscious idea in my head that I don't need him. That I think that I can go without him. And pride and the Holy Spirit does not sit right with each other. Because the Bible says in James 4 verse 6, "God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble." Pride resists God, therefore God resists pride. You guys are with me? But the moment our heart is humble and says, "Father, I need you. Lord, I need you," then the Holy Spirit will come in and do what he needs to do. So we need to set aside the pride that we have. And we see the exact same thing happen with Peter and John when they couldn't drive out the demon out of the girl. You know, and they asked Jesus, "Why couldn't we drive out the demon?" And then he says, "Because of your unbelief. How long shall I be with you, foolish ones?" And then he says to them, "Listen, this demon only comes out by prayer and fasting." It's not that prayer and fasting generates more Holy Spirit power. It's just that prayer and fasting makes you more God conscious. So what Jesus is telling them, you started to get self-pride as the demons started to get delivered out of people. You saw what was happening and you thought, "Wow, look at us. Look at what we are doing. Look at the power that flows through us." Until you were faced with a stubborn demon. Because the demon is not scared of you, he's scared of the one in you. And so when you're self-conscious, you function out of your own power, and then that will be the result of that. And Jesus told them, "You were functioning out of self-pride. Go back into the inner room, go pray to your Father who sees in secret, get your consciousness right, and power again will start to flow out of you." And then lastly, I want the band, if you guys can join me on stage. The third thing we can do to walk more with God in the Holy Spirit is to stop trying to live right. And I did mention that. There was a church in Galatians. They were obviously you know, well-known Christians, and they were salted Christians, and but they fell into a trap of self-performance. And they thought that we can operate in more power by doing the right things. Again, it's self-effort. Doesn't get you anywhere. Now, Paul sees this. Now, you'll notice, when Paul writes to sons of God, his tone of voice differs. He's more straightforward. It's as if he comes across a bit aggressive. That's maybe not the right word, but he's very straightforward. Doesn't play games. But when he writes to those who are non-Christians, he writes with a graceful tone of voice. But now Paul writes to the church, listen, Galatians 3. Listen to what he says. Oh, foolish Galatians. Not, okay, so listen, guys. So I need to speak to you about, you know, that one thing, you know, but maybe we can have like a cup of coffee, and I just like to share some ideas with you, and maybe just like a different angle as to how you can just live a bit. It was like straight, you foolish Galatians. Who has cast an evil spell on you? For the meaning of Jesus Christ's death was made as clear to you as if you had seen a picture of his death on the cross. Then verse 2, he says, let me ask you this one question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the law of Moses? In other words, by living right? Of course not. You received the Spirit because you believed the message you heard about Christ. How foolish can you be? After starting your new lives in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort? Have you experienced so much for nothing? Surely it was not in vain, was it? Verse 5. I ask you again, does God give you the Holy Spirit and work miracles among you because you obey the law? Of course not. It's because you believe the message you heard about Christ. So the end goal of this message is that we all want to live in power. We all want to live this powerful life, but we have to get back to the basics. Let's just take one step back and say, I need to know the Holy Spirit better. I need to get to know Him personally. Because what happens in the private place will manifest in the public place. God says, Jesus says that your Father who sees what you do in secret, He will reward you openly. Get to know God first. Get to know yourself first before you are so concerned about your public ministry. Amen. And so, you have the Holy Spirit within you right now. And listen to Ephesians 1 verse 13. It's not on the screen. Paul says, in Him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in Him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit in you is the evidence that you are saved. And that's why we're going to have communion right now. Is to remind yourself that you are a glory carrier, that you carry the presence of God within you. You can get to know Him personally. So as we have communion today, let's just become aware of the presence of God in our lives. Let's honor the Holy Spirit within us. And let's not take His presence for granted. Amen. Let's have communion together. There are tables all over. And after that, we're going to go.